Morning, Kingsland. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Let's stand up. Let's worship this morning. Just an old song. I know we all like this one. Let's go ahead and sing I Saw the Light this morning. Here we go.
I wandered so aimless, not filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night.
Offering this morning.
Thank you.
Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Thank you so much for being at church today and singing and shouting and dancing and worshiping and exalting the name of our great God. And we are starting today's service off with the thing we absolutely love to do more than anything else. That's baptize somebody. And man, it's just a great day to be at Kingsland. And before I get into that, let me just remind you, if you didn't get a bulletin when you came in, make sure you get one, because we got lots of stuff to be aware of. Tonight is our family fun night at the Holiday Bowling Alley. And it won't be the same if you're not there. You need to come. It's going to be great, okay? So 6:30, come out. It's cheap. It's fun. But mostly it's just a chance to be together. And there's a Pac-Man machine there. Just going to tell you that ahead of time. Or there was last year when I was there. But so it's really something to come back and get to know some friends and make new friendships and just have fellowship together and even bowl a little bit if you want to. Saturday afternoon is our music ministry picnic for the choir, the praise band, the sound people, anybody involved in music ministry or sound or video or any kind of to do with that, please come be with us for that. And then Saturday, August 22nd, is our back to school bash. That is on Saturday. Sunday, we're having a one-day revival. Clayton Jennings will be with us Saturday night and Sunday morning, and Pastor Mike will tell you more about that in a minute. But you just want to make plans to be here. It'll be something different than we've ever done before. It'll be great. And so people are going to get saved. And some of your friends, if you'll bring them, they will come to Jesus. And I think even church people that have been in church but have never come to Jesus will be coming to Christ through this weekend of services. And then we're going to take, that's for us, that's here, and then we're going to take it out. We're going all the way to Baltimore on August 29th for our Bridge to Baltimore one-day mission trip. So I hope you'll avail yourself of that. There's a sign-up out on the mission board you can sign up on. Into anger, but rather bring those little ones up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. That's what we do with our kids. That's what we're trying to do. That's why we have our Bible studies. That's why we have Sunday school and Awana and all that. But at the end of the day, it's you, Mom and Dad, and we want to support you. And as a parent, I thank God for our teachers, all those VBS workers, keepers, the youth ministry, helping us reach our children. In that same chapter, Ephesians chapter 6, and Calvin's parents shared this with him today about the spiritual armor. Ephesians chapter 6, verse, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Our battle is a spiritual battle, and we put on the helmet of salvation. But first, gets baptized, they need to be saved. And baptism does not save you. But once you're saved, once you've been born again, we want to baptize you. That's the first step of obedience. To the gospel. Take the sword of the Spirit and we do battle. Shield of faith. And we have everything we need to defeat the evil one if we will utilize those tools. And that's the kind of training that Calvin is getting in his house on a morning like this, and he's given his heart to Jesus. Come on down here, Calvin. I want to show you off to everybody. He's an expert swimmer, so if anything goes wrong in this baptismal, he said he can swim his way out. Step up there so people can see you. All right. Of your family. You guys mean it all to me. And this question, bud, like I asked you down there a few minutes ago, in your life and to save you and to forgive you, and have you made him your Lord and your Savior? Well, that's awesome, buddy. I'm so proud of you, and we're proud of you. Based on your public profession of faith and obedience to our Lord's command, I baptize you, my little brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with him in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Watch this video.
It seems like our generation is dying to be heard. So many have found a voice in the spoken word. We're dying to be heard and we're dying for truth. and you wonder why the church is losing the youth. They say 2 in 3 kids will leave the church. 2 in 3 kids in a brand new search. A search for something real. A search for love. Because they never found it in the church growing up. Had they been looking for judges, they'd still be around. Because the pews seem to be full of that kind of crowd. Know-it-all men and gossiping girls. And Jesus said be loved to the rest of the world. But no, not anymore. Most feel judged when they walk through the door. But if the church woke up, and the people did too, they'd realize they're no better than me or you. You see, Jesus never said, I will make you sinless. He said, I'll grant you life and I'll help you through this. So while many Christians scoff with their proud looks, they haven't taken the time to read this book. Because if they did, they'd lower their head. They'd show love to the world and they'd be humble instead. You see, you did nothing for your salvation, nothing at all. It was a free gift God gave you, a gift he offers to all. You see, going to church doesn't make you a good person. You aren't better than others because you listen to a sermon. If you're truly a Christian, then you know what you are. You are a desperate sinner who was struck by a star, hopeless and lost in your sin. So why is it self that Christians boast in? You see, Jesus despised the religious, the haughty and the proud. Maybe we should put that on church signs and speak it out loud. I've seen lives ruined and people turned away, all because of churchgoers who had nothing good to say. People who claimed Christ but failed to live it. People who wanted love but failed to give it. People who the youth refused to follow. So the youth leave the church because to them the church is hollow, just filled with people with nothing good to say. And you wonder why our generation is walking away. We're desperate for love and we're looking for life. So stop ruining the church and start proclaiming Christ. Take it from a kid who grew up in the pews, a kid from a generation forced to choose. Leave the church because of the fake people in it, or stay for Christ who showed love and meant it. The 2 in 3 who leave are part of the problem too. Because instead of being the solution, quitting is what they do. You see, they let the wolves in sheep clothing win. Instead of staying for Jesus, they leave because of men. So I'll be the 1 in 3 who stays under the steeple. Because I'd rather stay for Jesus Christ than leave because of people.
That's Clayton Jennings. He will be here in just a couple weeks. And he's got a really great heart for youth. He's only 27, I believe, himself. And he's on fire for God. He's going out and just preaching and spoken word. He does a lot of that. But he just has a good message for everyone. And I'm hoping that on the 22nd that night, if you know anyone at all, and you have a friend that you know they're battling, and maybe they're not saved, maybe they're not exactly where they need to be, make sure they're here that night. It's free. Free of charge to all students 18 and under. I think it's a $5 suggested donation for adults. If someone can't come, we're going to let them in anyway, one way or the other, because they need to hear the gospel. And youth, the video is just, stand strong to Jesus. No matter what anyone says or judges or whatever like that, because Jesus Christ is one that is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he will never leave us. So let's stand this morning and continue to worship that very thing. We know that God is strong and that he's able and he's always going to be there for us.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, fear no will fear no
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, your love is marvelous. We all are sinners condemned to die, except you took the penalty for our sin on yourself. And Father, you've blessed us so much. And now as we come to worship you, we bring our tithes and offerings and just a little bit of thankfulness for what you've done for us, but we want to be obedient to your word. We pray that you'll use it for the building of your kingdom. In Jesus' name. Thank you.
last Sunday morning, we talked about Daniel being thrown in the lion's den, and we talked about how his prayer life was well established before he was ever thrown into the lion's den. And today we're going to talk about Daniel in the five kingdoms, and we'll get to that in just a minute. But I asked you if you would take the challenge to pray multiple times, morning, afternoon, lunch. Many of you took that challenge, and I felt like we should have done this last week, so I want to pick up from last week today, and that is to take a season of prayer, quiet prayer. Find a partner, maybe a person, and you may not like doing that. You may be a totally private prayer. Pray by yourself if you want to, but right now I'd like to ask you to find a partner if you like doing that, if you feel comfortable doing that. And one of you, pray. You can pray for your church. You can pray for your needs. You can pray for your own personal heartaches, sickness, illness, your country. We have a revival coming up in just a few weeks. It's a one weekend kind of thing for the youth and then for us. We need to pray for that. We just had an awesome, awesome outpouring of God's Spirit with our VBS and kids coming to Christ. And you know what? Satan hates that, and he hates us. And with that comes all kinds of problems and attack. We need to be prayed up. And may we never be the ones who talk about prayer and don't do it, right? Let's pray. I'm being told we need to dismiss Kids Zone. So while the kids are leaving for Kids Zone, that's a K through second, can go to Kids Zone if they like. Find your partner. Let's take a season of soft, quiet prayer together. Let's pray. And we pray all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Open with me, if you would, your Bibles to the seventh chapter of Daniel. We're going to discuss Daniel in the five kingdoms. And no, this is not The Hobbit. We don't have any videos or anything. But Daniel in the five kingdoms, the Babylonian kingdom, the Medo-Persian kingdom, the Greek kingdom, the Roman kingdom, and then the fifth kingdom is God's kingdom, and that is yet to come. God is sovereign and in complete control of human history. Therefore, his kingdom will ultimately prevail. We pray, even so come, Lord Jesus. We pray, Lord, help us with this sickness, with this situation, with our nation, with our workplace and all this kind of thing. Just understand that in the end, his kingdom will prevail. Whatever you do, make sure you're on his side. Make sure you're on the right side. We trust him by faith. But he's given us good reason. He's given us evidence to evaluate the facts. You see, this text provides an overwhelming argument that the Bible is trustworthy, that God is God. Now, what you're going to have to do is take this text and compare it to the text in Revelation, and then maybe open up your world history books and read about what happened in world history, and then open your heart. Listen, this could be life-changing. If you understand what's happening in Daniel chapter 7 and 8, it's awesome. Now, people in every generation have to decide whether to live their lives focused on what is immediate, what is temporal, what is carnal, what is fleshly, or to live for that which is eternal, that which is permanent, that which is long-term. Almost every decision you make, do you eat the grapes or the brownie sundae? Which do you do, right? The immediate, happy, ooh, that's great, the pizza, and oh, that's yummy, and then within hours you're regretting that, right? Or do you make the long-term decision? That's just a microcosm. Those who choose to defy God by living lives in disobedience to him and really living it up today in the flesh and building their lives on the shifting sands of what they can see now, they will be profoundly disappointed in eternity. But those who choose to live their lives for Christ by faith will be blessed eternally, infinitely, and in the short term. Even people who defy God, who don't believe in God, agnostics, atheists, whatever, think Christianity is bogus. Often they find meaning in some great cause. They realize that this world, there's just not enough pleasure and fun to be had. So they'll seek causes. They devote their lives to saving the planet, feeding the hungry. Some of these things are good things, right? Those are good things. Saving the whales, I guess that's a good thing. Or the lions, or the doggies and the kitties. Anything other than human babies in the womb. And they devote their things to things like overpopulation. I was taught that in high school. The world is overpopulating. We were supposed to fall off the axis by now. That was 1991. We should have been falling off the axis and rolling off into oblivion a long time ago. Somehow we're still making it. All those pesky, nasty human beings keep getting born. I mean, think about it. What is wrong with people? Overcrowding, man caused global warming, larger than life issues that really matter. They want their lives to make a difference. You know, a proper understanding of Daniel's prophecy will drastically impact one's views on what really matters in this life. So what I'm saying is people who are religious, people who aren't really religious, most people would like to say something like, I'd really like to make a difference in this world. I'd like to do something good with my life, something like that. Most people would say that. Well, if that's really your heart, if you understand Daniel's prophecies in chapter 7 and 8, it could really change your life. Daniel 7 is regarded as one of the most important texts in all of the Old Testament. The writings that make up from 7 and forward are prophetic and apocalyptic. The first half of the book is Daniel sharing stories, amazing stories about him and his friends. But the second half is about prophecy. It's about the future. Daniel accurately predicts the fate of four world kingdoms in succession, one after the other. He either got really lucky or he had some help. Which is it? Because he was right. Scholars look back and go, he was right. He's so accurate that they go back and say, well, he must have written it after the fact. He couldn't have written that 500 years before the birth of Christ. He must have written it after the fact because he's so accurate. How did he get so lucky? This string of, you know, do you remember in, let's get worldly here for a minute. Do you remember in the movie Back to the Future, Biff, one of my favorite characters, Biff, old man Biff, went back to young man Biff and gave him the 1995 almanac with all the winners of all the horse races and stuff. Remember that? And then Biff, of course, went on to be a multi-billionaire because he knew how to bet. And do you remember that? Fun story, but it's a fairy tale, okay? I mean, even in the story, they went back and erased that. So even if you're a Back to the Future person, that never really happened because they went back before that and Marty McFly took the thing out of his back pocket, right? But it's a fun, adventurous comedy, fairy tale, whatever. I was thinking the other day, driving down the road in my black car, if I could get it up to 88, which it would do. It can get you in trouble. But if it went, shot me back to the future, like in the movie, that I would be back to when the movie came out 30 years ago, back to 1985. And man, it's just weird to think. 1955 seemed like a long, long time ago back in 85. Well, today, that's how far 1985 was away. Again, just a fun story, adventurous, it's a fairy tale. Listen, what we're reading about here is true. There's a difference between watching a movie where they pretend about going back in time and reading the Bible where this guy named Daniel authenticated his message. Daniel wrote chapter 7 during Babylonian rule. And the visions we're going to read about right now was given to him 500 years before the birth of Christ, not written after the events took place, as liberal theologians have unsuccessfully tried to convince us. In this chapter, along with chapter 2 and in chapter 8, he predicts the soon coming Medo-Persian Empire. Now that would have been treason to say the Medes are coming, the Persians are coming, but he predicts that. Then the Greek Empire, which is hundreds of years away at that point. And then lastly, the Roman Empire, which was really hundreds and hundreds of years away. This is not Nostradamus, folks. This is not palm reading. This is not John Edward or the horoscope. This is real. If you have a heart and mind for truth, and if your heart and mind is genuinely open, this could change your view of Scripture and your life, your eternity. There's a reason why theologians think this is one of the most important chapters in all the Old Testament, because it verifies, it authenticates that the Bible is a supernatural book. Any book that's written that predicts four kingdoms in a row accurately without making any mistakes, somebody knows something, and there's no way they just got lucky. What's the probability of that? When you compare Daniel's writings with John's inspired writings in the Revelation, you gain a clear picture about the fate of mankind on earth. These two books offer more information about the future than any others in the Bible. And if you want to know how it all ends from an authoritative source, then just open up your Bible and read it. And in the spirit of that, I'm going to do that right now. Open up your Bible to Daniel first. Daniel chapter 7. We'll read Revelation 2 later. But Daniel chapter 7, and let's just let the prophecy speak for itself. There's no way we're going to get all this done today. We're just tipping our toes into it, okay? We're going to take at least 2 weeks on this. We're not going to rush it. We're going to take our time because this is absolutely essential. This is where our friends that like us, that think, oh, you're a nice guy, but you're kind of a religious nut. You're kind of a freak for believing the Bible. This is, you're either that, or you believe something that is authoritative and true and proven. There's evidence here. So if you have an open mind, open up to Daniel chapter 7 and read it with an open mind and let the Lord speak to you. And it's a puzzle. You got to put together 7 and 8 and 2 and Revelation 13 and 19. And when you put together the puzzle, it's this beautiful picture that could change your life. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel saw a dream and visions of his head, and he lay in his bed. Then he wrote down the dream and told the sum of the matter. Now, I'm not going to interrupt again other than to say this. We're going back in time, okay? He's back to Belshazzar. Okay, so he's back to Babylon. The events in chapter 5 happened after this. So the book isn't chronologically in order, okay? Daniel declared, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea, and the four great beasts came out of the sea, different from one another. The first was like a lion and eagles, and had eagle's wings. Then as I looked, its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man. And the mind of a man was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second one, like a bear. It was raised up on one side. It had 3 ribs in its mouth between its teeth, and it was told, arise, devour, eat much flesh. After this, I looked, and behold, another like a leopard with 4 wings of a bird on its back, and the beast had 4 heads, and dominion was given to it. After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a 4th beast, terrifying and deceitful and exceedingly strong. It had great iron teeth that devoured and broke in pieces and stamped what was left with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had horns, 10 horns. I considered the horns and behold, there came up among them another horn, a little horn, before which 3 of the first horns were plucked up by the roots. And behold, in the horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. Now listen, if this is the first time you're ever reading this, it's a little hard to keep up with, and it probably sounds a little crazy. Okay, you're having a hard time grasping it. Be patient. Maybe do some homework on your own with this. Do some study on your own. But don't give up yet, okay? Because a lot of this is going to be explained later. As I looked, in verse 9, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames. Its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued, and it came out from before him. Thousands and thousands served him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. And the court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. I looked then because of the sound of the great words that the horn was speaking. Back to that little horn a few minutes ago. And as I looked, I saw the wild beast was killed, and its body destroyed and given over to be burned with fire. As for the rest of the beasts, their dominion was taken away, but their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. So all of the beasts, all of the kingdoms were destroyed. And I saw that night visions, and I saw the night visions. Behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like a son of man. What did Jesus refer to himself repeatedly in the New Testament as? The Son of Man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion was an everlasting dominion which should not pass away, and his kingdom one that should not be destroyed. We're looking at the Trinity in the Old Testament, God the Father giving dominion to God the Son. As for me, in verse 15, Daniel, my spirit within me was anxious, and the visions of my head alarmed me. Wouldn't they alarm you if you saw the apocalyptic events of the rest of history and the end of the world? Yeah, it would alarm me too. I approached one of those who stood there and asked him the truth concerning all this. So he told me and made known to me the interpretations of things. These four great beasts are four kings who shall rise out of the earth. So the prophecy is already explaining itself. Four kings, four kingdoms that will arise in the future. But the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever. And that's why I called this Daniel in the five kingdoms, okay? The fifth kingdom is the king, under the king, Jesus. Then I desire to know the truth about the fourth beast, which was different from all the rest, exceedingly terrifying with its teeth of iron and claws of bronze, which devoured in broken pieces and stamped that which was with its feet. Now this is kind of interesting, because next chapter he's going to talk to middle kingdoms, the Persians and the Greeks. But right now he's asking about that ferocious beast, the fourth kingdom. And it had 10 horns that were on its head. The other horn that came up before with the three of them fell. The horn that had eyes, a mouth that spoke great things and seemed greater than his companions. As I looked, the horn made war with the saints and prevailed on them. Have you ever felt that way, saints? Like you're being prevailed against? Like you're losing the battle? It was prophesied long ago. Until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given for the saints of the Most High, and the time was when the saints possessed the kingdom. Thus, and that's future tense, folks. That's still future tense today. Thus he said, as for the fourth beast, there shall be a fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be different from all the kingdoms, and it shall devour the whole earth and trample it down and break it to pieces. As for the 10 horns, out of this kingdom, 10 kings shall arise, and another shall arise after them. He shall be different from the former ones and shall put down 3 kings. He shall speak words against the Most High. He shall wear out the saints of the Most High. Do you feel worn out today? I do. It's hard to watch the news without feeling worn out. It's only going to get worse. And shall change, and shall think to change the times and the law, and they shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. It's 3.5 years. But the court shall sit in judgment, and his dominion shall be taken away to be consumed and destroyed to the end. And the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, and his kingdom shall be an everlasting kingdom. All dominions shall serve and obey him. Here is the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly alarmed me, and my color changed, but I kept the matter in my heart. I was white as a ghost when I saw all this stuff, and then when it was explained to me. So, what are we going to do over the next few minutes, and then next week, and maybe longer? We're going to try to make sense of how this chapter of Scripture fits into the whole of Scripture. And it is awesome. It is overwhelming. When you really, again, read your history books. Go home and study this on your own. Pull out your commentaries if you want to. See what John MacArthur has to say about it, and David Jeremiah has to say about it, and Tim LaHaye has to say about it, and trustworthy sources when it comes to prophecy, and all sources when it comes to prophecy are not trustworthy. Many are. And I want to be the most trustworthy possible, so I'm not going to go out on a limb and start making bold predictions. God has not told me when, you know, the rapture is going to happen. I have no idea. It's not guaranteed to happen in our lifetime. It could happen right now, but I don't know. God is sovereign, though, and he's in complete control of human history. Therefore, his kingdom will ultimately prevail. So whose team do you want to be on? Whose kingdom do you want to associate your life with? His kingdom. In the first year, go back to chapter 7, verse 1, and we're going to talk through the first 2 or 3 verses. That's it. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel saw a dream and a vision, his head as he lay on his bed. Then he wrote down the dream, and he told the sum of the matter. That's verse 1. This event takes place during the final days of the Babylonian Empire. The events of chapter 7 of Daniel chronologically occur before chapter 5. I know it's hard to keep up with sometimes. Nebuchadnezzar's wicked grandson, Belshazzar, is ruling alongside his dad, Nabonidus. By now, everyone who knows anything about Daniel should be listening closely to the interpretations of his dreams. Because of this dream, we can understand how Daniel was not all that surprised when Belshazzar called him to explain the writing on the wall. Now, I want to give a word of warning at the very beginning here. I believe that we as Americans are living in very similar peril. Just like the Babylonians, we think we're strong and secure and powerful, but we're really getting weaker all the time, spiritually, militarily, morally, politically, financially. As believers, we should not worry. We should not fear. Write down 2 Timothy 1:7 and Philippians 4:6. Don't worry. Don't fear. But we should pray like crazy and for our nation, for our church, for our friends, for our family. We should participate in the process however we can, run for office, vote for the person who's right that's running for office, all that kind of thing, and prepare for what is coming. And don't shake in your boots and don't be weak. And it's not a time for cowards. It's time to man up or woman up and to teach our kids to do the same. And I actually thought about the difference between Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar. Nebuchadnezzar, the granddad, listened to Daniel. And he had time to make changes, which he must have made some, but really he didn't make enough. When Daniel gave him his warning, and when you read Daniel chapter 2, you see the four kingdoms there too with that statue, okay? Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome. It's there in chapter 2 also. But Nebuchadnezzar had time to change. He was given an opportunity to change. What really scares me to death is the story of Belshazzar. He saw the writing on the wall, and a few hours later, he was dead, and the kingdom was conquered. So how seriously are we going to take these admonitions, these warnings? And are we more like Nebuchadnezzar or more like Belshazzar? In verse 2, Daniel declared, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea, and four great beasts came up out of the sea, different from one another. So the four beasts each represent successive kingdoms. Now, the two-part message we're doing right now, Daniel and the five kingdoms, presumes there's a fifth kingdom, which they talk about. That's Christ's kingdom, his soon-coming kingdom, and we need to be aware of it. No Hollywood thriller has ever come close to depicting the horrific scenes that play out in this story. God is a holy judge who will someday take vengeance on rebellious humanity. Now, that's the meanest thing you're going to hear me say all day, but it's true. God's a holy judge. He does not tolerate our rebellion. He loves us, and he's offered us grace as a gift, but listen to this. Time is running out. That's why we're bringing in Clayton Jennings. That's why we did VBS. That's why we did summer camp. That's why we're going out and telling people about Jesus. That's why we do Sunday morning. That's why we do Wednesday night. Time is running out. It's not always going to be the way it is right now. There's an age of grace that's been extended. We don't know how long it's going to be extended, but we're living in this church age. But time's running out. He loves you, he loves me, and he never guaranteed you the opportunity to hear it in the first place. If you've heard the gospel, if you've heard the truth, and you're living in open rebellion, listen, you need to understand, God's holy wrath will be satisfied. He sees what you're doing. He knows all about it. And we should take that seriously. We should be in awe of that. We should love one another, but we should love one another enough to say, hey, what are you doing? In fact, we should love ourselves enough to say, Lord, what am I doing? To be still and know that he's God and say, search me, O God. Know my heart. See if there's any wicked way in me. I want it out. I don't want anything to do with that stuff. But see, we're flesh and we're attracted like a bug to the lights, right? And that's part of the Christian life is just living and choosing Jesus over choosing your flesh. Every day it's a new opportunity to do that. Look at verse 4. The first beast was like a lion. It had eagle's wings. And as I looked, the wings were plucked off. It was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and the mind of a man was given to it. Now, history tells us that Babylon was often depicted as a lion, and so was Nebuchadnezzar. That was his image, the lion. Archaeologists have located lions with wings that guarded and stood at attention at the gates of the royal palace. The wings being plucked off in the mind of man may refer to Nebuchadnezzar and his 7 years of insanity. We've already studied that. So the lion with the wings is clearly Babylon. Now, there are other reasons to draw that conclusion. That's the most simple one, okay? As we move forward, there is explicit words that are said about these next two kingdoms. Behold, in verse 5, another beast, a second one, like a bear. It was raised up on the side It had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth, and it was told, "Arise, devour much flesh." The bear is Medo-Persia. The Medes, the Persians. And the greater side was Persia. That's the empire everybody knows of. That was the stronger member of the partnership. Three ribs refer to the three vanquished foes that they conquered to take over world power. After this, I looked, and behold, another like a leopard with four wings of a bird on its back, and the beast had four heads, and dominion was given to it. And I want to remind you again, the Medes, the Persians, and the Greeks will be explicitly explained in the next chapter. But it's pretty obvious that the leopard refers to Greece, who swiftly conquered the world. Alexander the Great ruled from Europe to Africa to India, and he did it in 10 years. It's said that he wept because there was no more lands to conquer at 33 years old. Then, of course, he died. The four heads of the leopard signify the four generals who reigned after Alexander the Great's death when he was only 33 years old. Chapter 8 of Daniel will provide explicit details about the Medes and the Persians and the Greeks using the illustrations of a ram and a goat. Now listen, some of y'all can keep up with your favorite soap opera, God forbid, I hope you're not watching those, but your favorite show or your board game or Minecraft or whatever you're into, you can keep up with this, okay? It's going to switch to rams and goats in the next chapter. But it's talking about the same thing in chapter 8, verse 20. The ram with two horns, Medes and Persians. They're the kings of Media and Persia. And the male goat is the kingdom of Greece. So when you read chapter 8, if you want to read ahead, it's the same story. Now go look at verse 7. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, terrifying and dreadful and exceedingly strong. It had great iron teeth. Flashback to chapter 2 when it talked about the iron and the clay mixing for Rome. It devoured and broke in pieces and stomped what was left with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another horn, a little horn, before which three of the first horns were plucked up by the roots. This is one bad dude. And behold, in his horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. Now, I believe that the Antichrist is the little horn. And I believe the Antichrist could be alive today, preparing for his role in the end times events. Next week, we will study in more detail and see the fourth beast. Obviously, it's Rome, led by various kings in the past, and a revived Roman Empire led by the Antichrist in the future. Of course, for Daniel, that was the distant future, right? 2,500 years ago when he was writing. But it's the near future for us, ladies and gentlemen. We're living in the last days. If Daniel accurately predicted all four empires, shouldn't we listen to what he has to say? Imagine if somebody accurately predicted the next four presidents of the United States, or the next four Mrs. America, or the next four whatever. We would be astounded if history proved that that guy was right. My personal testimony is in 1997 or 8, I remember studying Daniel in detail in a seminary class under Dr. James D. Price, who is a scholar of scholars. It changed my life. See, I grew up in church like a lot of you. I grew up believing like a lot of you. But I'm telling you, there is so much evidence historically for what this book is teaching. It is not a feel-good story. It is not, well, ushy-gushy, I love Jesus, or I love Allah, or I love Buddha, or whatever. There is facts. There is evidence for what we believe. Now, I want to take one diversion before we call it a day, and I want you to go over to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. If you have your Bible, go over to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And we're going to read about this Antichrist. Second Thessalonians chapter 2. My little subscript in my Bible says, "The man of lawlessness." Let's read about the Antichrist. Now, we know in 1 John, John said there's many Antichrists. Anybody who's anti-God is Antichrist. Make sure your favorite musician isn't Antichrist. If he is, get rid of him. Or your favorite movie star, or your favorite book author, your favorite whatever, news person. The spirit of Antichrist is working right now. But there is an Antichrist, the Antichrist, in chapter 2 of Thessalonians. Everybody there? In verse 1, we're going to read the whole thing, so let's just do it. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus and our being gathered together to him, we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by spirit or by spoken word or letter sent from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you in that way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. So Paul was saying, look, folks, Jesus has not returned. When Jesus went up on that cloud and ascended, most of his followers were like, tomorrow, maybe he'll come back. Next week, maybe he'll come back. Next year, they didn't think they would outlive the return of Christ. That's 2,000 years ago. Thousands of people have outlived the return of Christ. He's not yet returned. Verse 4, this Antichrist opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Now, we understand that will happen during the tribulation period based on other scriptures. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you about these things? And you know that what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. Hey, God is sovereign. He's in control. Make sure you're on his side. He's restraining things right now. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. We're living in the age of church, the church age of grace. Free offer of salvation is laid out for you this morning if you want to take it. There will come a time when things will change dramatically and he will be out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. Right now in Revelation 19, you can read all about it. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders, and with all wicked deception for those who are perishing because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. It reminds me of the old hymn, rescue the perishing, care for the dying. You know, I have a lot of admiration for firefighters and police officers and military folks who sacrifice their lives. We are God's army. We are God's firefighters, and we're climbing up into buildings that very well may collapse. We're risking our lives. We are rescuing the perishing. We are caring for the dying because Jesus is wonderful. Jesus will save anyone who'll take it. That's our job. That's what we do. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion so they may believe that which is false. And of course, I believe that's talking about tribulation times. In order that all may be condemned who do not believe in the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. And it goes on basically to say that we need to stand strong. We don't know when Christ is coming back. And today's message, and probably next Sunday's message, is not designed to give all my ideas on exactly, you know, how Christ is going to come back and what he's going to do. My guess is he's going to come back at a time I didn't think he was, and he's going to do some things I didn't think he would do. But here's the fact. He is coming back. And this kingdom will be established. And before his kingdom can be established, there's some really awful things that have to take place. But he will stomp out Satan. I want to ask you today, in closing, if this information is simply facts and claims that you're adding to the library of your mind, or are these life-changing truths that will motivate you to live differently, to spend differently, to entertain differently, to behave differently? Listen, Daniel wrote a book in the Bible, and he predicted that the kingdom he was in would fall to the Persians, who would fall to the Greeks, who would fall to the Romans, hundreds of years before that happened. And then he said a holy one would be anointed, but he would be cut off without hands. He was talking about Jesus. And he said when Jesus would come in chapter 9, we'll get to that in a few months, he said that he will come 483 years after the order to build Jerusalem, to rebuild Jerusalem. Jerusalem had been destroyed. Well, about 400 years B.C., Artaxerxes gave that command to rebuild Jerusalem. And right at about 5 centuries later, a man named Jesus was born. He claimed to be God. He died on a cross, he was buried, and he rose from the grave. There's a lot of Josephus and other historians talk about that being fact. And he said he was going to come again, and he said he was going to crush out not just Antichrist, but everyone who is Antichrist. That ought to get your attention, folks. Gets my attention. So are these just facts and figures? Maybe I've gone too fast. Maybe I'll try to slow down a little bit more next week, but I'm so excited about this. This has changed my life, and I want it to change yours. Here's the invitation prayer I just want you to consider making this morning. Something like this: Lord, I don't know when Christ will return, but I want to live as if it could happen today. I don't know when he's going to return. I don't know if we're ever going to have the Clayton Jennings revival. I hope so. I don't know if I'm going to have tomorrow, But I want to do what he's called me to do today. And I mess it up regularly. And I fall so short. And I'm constantly going back and asking the Lord for forgiveness. Just this morning, preparing for this message, I had such a weight on my heart. I spent hours reading and studying and reading and reading and studying. And I hadn't even written a single note. Because I'm just fascinated by it. And I love reading this stuff and even rereading it. And yet, every Sunday at 11, I'm supposed to get up here and talk. And it's good if I have some notes to talk from, you know. I don't just wing it. But I got to tell you, man, it really just overwhelmed me, this the sense of what an obligation it is to come up here and dispense truth. I don't want to say the wrong thing. I don't want to do the wrong thing. I don't want to lead you in the wrong direction. But I want to ask you if you'd make that your prayer this morning. I don't know when Christ is going to return, but I want to live as if it could happen today with my witnessing, my prayer life. How about serving? The fall is right around us. We have Awana. We have so many different ministries. We need servants who will take this message to little children because Jesus is coming back. We're going to reach them before he does. I don't know when he's going to return, but I want to live as if it could happen today. Loving, sharing, tithing, worshiping, forgiving, caring, sacrificing, confronting when necessary. It's no fun. You don't win any popularity contests when you confront, do you? Healing, helping, giving, glorifying God, and warning others about his return as if it could happen right now. Would you make that your prayer? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me as we come to a close? Next week, we'll knock out as much of the rest of this chapter as we can. God is sovereign. But it's amazing, he doesn't force himself on you. He's sovereign, he's in control, he's in complete control of human history. And his kingdom's gonna prevail, but it's your choice whether or not you accept him and receive his forgiveness. Now today, what I've tried to prove to you and what I've tried to tell you, it's not just some leap of faith out into nothingness. There's facts that go along with this. So if you need to give your heart to Jesus, I encourage you to do that today. Ask him to come into your life and to forgive you. Give him your everything, all your habits, all your lifestyles, all your sins. Ask him to forgive you. See, he died for you and he rose from the grave. He's the only one that can save you. He will save you if you ask him to. And we have folks that will pray with you and talk to you about how to do that if you'd like to come forward during the invitation and have someone pray with you. If you want to join our church, a church that is all about the Word of God, come forward and request that. If you've never been baptized, or for that matter, if you got baptized when you weren't even saved, come forward. We'll baptize you. I'll baptize you right now. There's water in the tank. The only requirement is that you're saved, born again. And the way you know you're saved is if you've been changed. God never saved anybody he didn't change. If you want to pray about an issue in your life or a loved one or whatever, just come and pray at the altar. You don't need to wait for me. Just come and pray if you want to do that. But will you make this your prayer this morning, Christians? I don't know when Christ will return, but I want to live as if it could happen today. In my witness, in my prayer life, in my service, in my loving others unconditionally, in my tithing, my finances, in my worship, and forgiving others, caring, sharing, sacrificing, confronting, healing, helping, giving, glorifying God, and warning others about his soon return as if it could happen today. Lord God, motivate us. Help us not just to take academic pursuits of your word. Lord, it is not an academic book exclusively. It's not a historical book exclusively or a scientific book exclusively. All of it is intended to change our lives and to change our behavior and to mold us and to shape us and to provoke us through the empowering of the Holy Spirit to do something differently than we've done it before. Lord, I pray that you'd help me to be more aware than ever of your return and for us to be more aware than ever of your return. We don't know when it's going to happen, but Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be a church that behaves and spends and plans and lives as if it could happen today. In Jesus' name. Would you stand with me? I want to ask you to think about what I've talked about today, if you want to pray at the altar, feel free to do that. Pray where you are. Come as the Lord leads you.
I'm feeling so small. Standing here weeping as I'm coming clean of the secrets I'm keeping, for I've caused so much pain to the ones I love most.
Thank you for being here today. Thank you for singing. Thank you for giving. Thank you for participating. And summertime's ending. We are having a sweet time of fellowship tonight. You know, we're always thinking about those who don't know the Lord yet. We're always thinking about how we can do a better job of discipling new Christians. We're always thinking of how can we worship more passionately. But keep in mind, if we don't learn to be a family and to hang out with one another and to love one another, what's 1 Corinthians 13 say about that? We have nothing. Okay, that's why we have those Bible fellowships on Sunday mornings where you can talk back and forth and dialogue and discuss. That's why we do some of these events, like tonight. You may not care about bowling. Neither do I. I hate bowling. But I love hanging out with people. Keep your hands and your kids out of the thing, the hole where the ball comes out, by the way. The people at Holiday Bowl appreciate that. But you know what? I love hanging out with people and just being a family. And that's what we're doing tonight. So please come back. We got a picnic in September on Labor Day weekend.
to get involved in, but that's a few weeks away. Part of our fellowship, man, we're so happy to see these little ones get saved and people join the church. And today, fruition really of probably months and months of activity of getting to know Ruth Sims. But she has come forward today to make it official. She's come and requested membership at Kingsland. So we're very thankful for that. Jeff and Diane are sitting here with her. They'll be standing up here after church. Make sure you come and let her know. This is someone who is already involved in serving. She has a heart for giving and helping get food to the hungry, and has helped us with our food pantry already. So it's great when folks come that are ready to just like pick up the load and help carry some of it. Man, we need that. So thank you, Ruth, for coming forward today. And we'll have a business meeting in September and vote in all our new members on that night in September. But I hope you have a great day, and we'll pray now and just hope all of you will come back and be with us on Sunday tonight at 6:30. Anything? Sometimes I start to pray and then you start talking, so I don't want to. Nothing. Okay. Come back at 6:30 tonight. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful worship this morning and just the sweet fellowship and spirit in this church. And we want more of it. We want more of you, Lord. We want your Holy Spirit to burn a fire in this place, a revival fire, and use us to in churches like us, to just see a mighty revival in our land and across the world. Lord, there are billions of people who still don't know you. Lord, help us to take that seriously. And help us to live holy lives. Help us to live chaste lives. Help us to live with pure and strong testimonies so that we can be heard. So we have we're in a position to tell people about Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, that our belief in your word is based on some amazing facts like the ones we're reading about right now in Daniel chapter 7. Help us to understand it. Help us to get our brains around it and realize we believe in a God who wrote a book that is historically accurate, where you prophesied, you predicted everything that would happen, including what's going to happen. So Lord, help us to live our lives today as if you could return today. And we thank you for Ruth. We thank you for growing our church. And we just pray that you just grow us each and every week. But Lord, help us to be healthy. Help us to love one another. Help us to know one another. And even tonight, Lord, just help us to have a good time fellowshipping with the family fun night. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.